Hello, everybody, and welcome to the FanFlux Podcast, episode 160, the New Year's episode. Yay!
Yay!
That sounded sarcastic, but that was legit. I'm very, very happy that this year's pretty much over. This episode should be coming out on Saturday, which is New Year's Eve. So, yay!
I'll be working on New Year's Eve.
Until what time?
Till 10:30
in the evening.
Yeah. I mean, I'll still probably make it in time for the frickin' ball drop, but it sucks.
I'm not sure what kind of person goes to KFC at 10:30 at night on New Year's Eve, but okay. I mean, if that's when they want to stay
Someone
open.
Who wants chicken.
I suppose they would want chicken. Yeah, that makes sense.
The store closes at 10, but I have to stay until like 10:30 or whenever I'm finished.
So I'm Casey.
Anyways.
How's it going?
Yeah. He's Casey.
I'm Casey. Hi. And we have Sisa.
Hello.
Zero.
Hey, everybody. I don't remember half of 2016.
And Patient.
Hi, I'm not Kenji618, but since I have a sore throat, my voice might sound a bit more like his.
You are closer.
Technically speaking, yes, but I still stand by the Microsoft Sam comment. Or that computer from, I think it was War Games.
Well, I assure you it's legitimate.
Wasn't
I'm
questioning
sorry,
it.
Dave.
That's not it, Zero. You
I
don't
can't
know your films.
To...
At all.
I don't. You're right. I've never even seen that movie. I'm just quoting the crap I've seen, and I just woke up an hour ago, so shut up.
So did I.
It's evening where you are.
Yeah, and?
I'm not even going to question it.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Motherfucker. All right. So... As we always start with what with starting words. Yay, the year's
okay,
over!
What have we been doing? How about that?
Yeah. Start with me. Let's start with me because I very rarely start and I have good news, yay.
What is it?
So, I had my hospital appointment yesterday.
So you're pregnant?
Fuck you, Zero. I appreciate the echo on that one, by the way, Patient. That was... I feel like, yes, it really did need saying twice. My neurology appointment yesterday. And it turns out I am cleared of all the things I was worried about. So... the shaking thing, people might remember from months ago, is not due to thyroid, it's not a heart condition, it's not diabetes, and it's not Parkinson's, which are all of the things that I was really, really worried about.
That's wonderful, Casey. I'm happy to hear that.
Yeah. So
what is it?
It's probably just... There are a few different kinds of benign tremors. They're not really sure which one it would be, but it doesn't especially matter since the treatment would probably be pretty much the same regardless, and that's beta blockers. So I'm going to get a prescription for those, and hopefully that'll fix it. So,
well, congratulations, man. I'm sure eating cereal will be much easier now.
Yeah, you...
Technically
you,
true,
You
yes.
joke... That was a legitimate concern. Like, I was considering ringing up and cancelling the appointment because I was like, it's probably not a big deal. Like, it's been 2 months and nothing serious has happened, and I'm probably fine. So I'll just not bother everyone with my stupid hypochondria and just not have the appointment. That's probably for the best. And then Christmas
That's
Day
That's how
happened.
Jim Henson died, Casey.
Yeah. Then Christmas Day happened, and I sat down to eat Christmas dinner with my parents, and trying to dish out food on my plate, pick up a small bowl of peas, weighed like a pound, and my hand was shaking so badly that my mom had to take the bowl off me lest I drop it. So,
Wow.
yeah.
Good job on being on the road to recovery, man. Now you can
So,
finally touch all the pee you want.
yeah. Wait, what?
In seriousness, though, Casey, we're very glad to hear that you're doing better and that nothing serious is happening.
Didn't say I was doing better. In fact, what happened on Christmas Day is probably a sign I'm doing worse. But, it's
I
nothing
joke because
serious,
I'm happy
serious.
for you.
So,
I
at least you
joke
know what
because
it
I'm
is
happy
now.
for you.
Or narrowed it down, that kind of thing.
Yeah. So, once I get that prescription, which could be anywhere for the next month or so, knowing my GP's office. Fucker. Yeah, so I should be able to start getting that treated.
You know, at least you're not gonna die.
Yeah, that's a plus.
Yeah. See? Look on the bright side of 2016.
So, full disclosure, we talked about what this episode was going to be, and it's going to be about 2016 because it's the New Year's episode and literally coming out on New Year's Eve. And I said we should talk about how shitty 2016 was, and Patient decided to play Life of Brian's Always Look on the Bright Side of Life for like, it was at least a minute because that's how long I tolerated it before I went to get a drink.
It was about 5 more seconds after you left.
Okay. So, yeah. Because jokes are always funnier when you explain them. So I did you a solid there, Zero. You're welcome. Yeah, what else
I'm
did
ready if
I
you don't respond to that.
do? What else did I do this week? What else did I do? I wrote and posted a chapter like today, like 6 hours ago.
Cool.
So, yeah, that was a thing. Got a bit stuck for a bit, and Slicer helped me out and brainstormed with me, which is
It was
appreciated.
fun.
Yeah.
What did you get for Christmas, little boy?
Oh, that's a point. I didn't even think of like what I got for Christmas. It's sitting in a bag over that way. You can't see but I'm pointing, and I can't get to it. I know one of my sisters got me one of those gift sets for like deodorant and shower gel and all that stuff.
Yay, hygiene.
And I got a new mouse, the electronic kind, to be clear.
Cool.
And chocolates and cash from grandparents, which is always appreciated. They have a tendency to give overly generously, considering circumstances, which is worrying. But, can't really. I mean, what do you say to that?
Yes.
Stop giving me money? Yeah, that's gonna go over well.
Yeah. Like, and even if
You
you do
say
say
give me
that, they're
more.
still gonna do it.
Generosity is a joy.
You say increase it by 5% every year.
Yeah, patient. That's always nice to say, but it becomes a question of can they afford to keep doing this? Like, they're retired, they're on pension. As far as I'm aware, not especially great pension. And
You know,
it's really
they
kind of
saved up
worrying.
that money to give it to you, so it would be insulting to not accept it,
I
I feel
know.
like.
That's the problem. 'Cause I'd rather they like have money to spend on themselves, especially when they need it. Like one of them recently had cancer and seems to be in the clear now, but I'd like them to have that money to do the stuff they want to do while they can, kind of thing.
I can understand that.
It's
Like
a fair
I'm okay not having the extra
point.
£30 on top of the other 20. It's fine. I'd be happy with smaller amounts and not quite as uncomfortable about it. But like I say, I can't really do anything about it, so it's fine. Yeah, so gifts, fun. What else did I do this week? With the chapter, doctor's appointment. I did some reading. I think I have a recommendation this week, so that's a plus. Finally getting some of those again, so I can actually have stuff to recommend on the podcast. Yay! That's pretty much... Oh, one more thing. Sasa asked me a couple of days ago, hey, are there any games between like $10 and $20 that you're interested in? And I said, like, not really. Like, if... Even if I got them, I probably wouldn't play them because I have such a backlog. And then, like, mm-hmm. 3 hours later, I bought Dead Rising 1 and 2.
Oh!
Well, so, they're super cheap, so, I mean, how can you resist? Hell, Dead Rising 3 is, like, $9.
Yeah.
Dead Rising 3 is not good, though.
I already have Dead Rising 3.
I enjoyed it, actually. I enjoyed Dead Rising 3.
Dead Rising 1 and 2 are great, though.
No, they're not.
They are.
One is great.
One is fun with the craft that it does. Like, you get it down to sort of being like a very formulaic type, oh, I go here, I get this, you know, because of the time. Like, it has you optimizing your gameplay as you play it.
It does, and people always complain about that. It's like, oh, I have to do this, this, and this, and this, and then I have to do this and this, and it's terrible, and I don't want to have to be stressed about all that stuff. I just want to fuck around. Here's the fun thing about Dead Rising. You can just stop doing that, save your game, and then just fuck around. And then just not save it. It's spectacularly easy to just fuck around in that game.
Yeah, but then you don't keep the experience. You're better off actually just doing that and then never even trying the quest to begin with. And then your second playthrough, when everything falls apart because you haven't done anything,
but
then you can do
that. You don't even particularly need the experience that much. I mean, once you get to, say, level 25, which you'll get through about halfway through your first playthrough, you don't really overly need any more levels after that. It's just a comfort thing beyond that. So, you know, it was a thing that people complain about that I thought was easily worked around, like, just by not saving and just having fun with it. Like, you can still do that easily, just... Yeah. It bothers me that it's something people complained about enough that they removed it.
Yeah.
It's easy enough, honestly. If you want to do the story, you can do the story. If you want to dick around, you can dick around, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
But I liked all their story, as silly as they were. That was kind of the point.
Yeah.
But the gameplay of one is painful to look back on. Mm. The second one was a little bit better, but it still had its flaws. The third one wasn't amazing, but it's a step in the right direction.
Yeah, I mean, the AI was the real big problem with the first one.
Yeah. When we get to my week, I played Dead Rising 4 recently, so I'll talk about it there.
Okay, we'll get to that then. Okay. Yeah, like, in the first one, it's surprisingly easy and kind of fun to just weave through zombies. Like, there is a very observable distance that zombies can lunge at you, so it's easy to just sort of dodge just out of that range and weave through a crowd of zombies without too much trouble. But the AI cannot do that, like, in any way, shape, or form. And the crowding of zombies is almost designed for you to actually do that. So if they can't, they can't get through that crowd. And that was probably the biggest problem.
So you need to just murder a line. And unfortunately, it takes long enough to do that that you'll attract every other zombie in the area. And it's just, yeah.
And each game, they just increase the amount of zombies they can show on screen.
Mm.
They do like doing that.
Well, that was... I think that was the biggest selling point of Dead Rising 1, because it was... you know, one of the early Xbox 360 games, and they're like, oh, you can have so many unique entities on the level map at once, and we won't do pop-in or anything like that. And that was cool, but, you know, it made for some awkward gameplay when it came to having to guide people through it.
Mm-hmm.
Also, those assholes that spawn in the courtyard every fucking day.
Yeah, that's why you murder them.
So that they can respawn at midnight. Yay!
But their music, though.
Music was pretty
solid. It was pretty good.
Yeah. So, I played that a little bit. That was fun. I played another level of Galgun Double Piece, and eh, think I might be over it, maybe, a little bit.
I can't see it stay lasting that long if you play it in a row, you know?
Not really. I mean, like I say, I played another level, longer, which was like 5 minutes, and I'm like, yeah, I think I'm good, kind of thing. So that was...
There's a reason why Time Crisis is just an arcade game.
Yeah.
I got a home version of Time Crisis, though, with a light gun and everything.
Yes,
and I played that game a lot.
Yeah, like, I did too.
So I don't know if that holds weight.
Well, that was with a light gun and everything, and not just, you know, moving.
Yeah, this doesn't have a light gun.
This doesn't have the coolness factor, and it has a squickness factor instead, and that's not a positive change.
Squick.
Fair enough.
Just bear with me. I forgot to do the list for today, so I'm just doing it really quick. Also, I accidentally typed recommendations. Which is the recommendations that Raccoon would make. It's a lot
Raccoon
of Dragon Ball Z stuff where the
Ginyu
Force front and center. Maybe one or two where he takes over the Ginyu Force and it becomes the Raccoon Force.
If we could all do Ginyu Force voices, this would be a much more fun podcast.
I don't know what the Ginyu Force voices sound like because I've only seen them in Dragon Ball Abridged.
Oh,
that's
really?
The best version of them. So you're fine.
You're fine.
Anyway, so I need to do the link dump for all the things that I just talked about. So I'm going to say I'm done for this week of what we're doing, and I'm going to move it on to...
Before we move on completely, though, speaking of the Ginyu Force and Dragon Ball Z Abridged, apparently the main character of Overlord in the dub is voiced by the same guy who does Dr. Gero in the Abridged.
Oh.
Dr. Gero, whatever.
That's actually really cool.
Yeah,
a friend of mine was very distracted and very amused while he watched that.
Yeah, that's General Ivan. That's he also does Cooler, and as I mentioned in a previous episode, he did a voice in Ruby this season.
Hmm.
Yeah. So, yeah. Probably one of the most, like, legit voice actors that DBZA has right now, I think. Like, I think he does more than most of the others do.
Hmm.
Yeah. So that's my week. We're gonna move on to Zero, so he can talk about Dead Rising, apparently. But also
so,
the stuff that he's done this week.
Yeah. So since we're just talking about it, my dad bought Dead Rising 4 while back when we went Christmas shopping, and so I finally decided I was gonna play it. So Dead Rising 4, they took away the time limit completely. So, yay. Go run around and do whatever, I guess. I mean, the story is basically Frank is there and he gets caught up in this conspiracy and turns into basically a wanted fugitive.
Mm. To be clear,
because
this is not like this is. What's the word for it? Where they just start everything over?
It's not a reboot or anything.
It basically
this
is.
This takes place much later. There are references to earlier games.
Really?
Yeah.
That's surprising
like
because Frank is like nothing like he is in the earlier games, but okay.
Basically, like, Frank finds out that the government, or some faction of the government, has been experimenting, cloning people, turning them into zombies for some unknown reason. I don't know why. Biological weapon, maybe. And he gets essentially caught because his pupil that he's working with, Vic, drives off without him. And, well, he gets basically identified and he has to flee on his own. And he becomes a wanted fugitive because it was apparently an Army Reserve training facility and he attacked people there, is what the news says. And so he goes and, you know, he goes into hiding and he becomes Hank East for a little while, which I found funny. And then he gets found. It's like, yeah, we need to go to Willamette. That's where everything's going down. And me and you need to go together. And this guy's like the head of like the zombie control agency or whatever.
Did the town repopulate or something?
Oh
What?
yeah, they repopulated. Like this is years, like many years after the original,
Yep, they
to the
cleaned off
point where
all the
they
blood stains and
the
all the
previous
viscera.
zombies, like the zombie strain, they had created a vaccine for it. Everybody was immune to the zombie strain now. But hey, there's a new zombie strain now, and you're not immune to it. Great. Where did this come from? Figure it out.
This sounds even more terrible than I thought it would be.
Like Frank is very, like the level of humor and stuff he displays isn't quite like the original at all, but at the same time, it's more like he's had to deal with a lot of crap, and the humor is how he hides his pain, sort of thing. 'Cause he's been screwed over again and again and again.
Sure, okay.
By the government and, you know, everything regarding that. And yeah, so you get set off and you're going to the mall. And yeah, you gotta go and find out the truth. The
Use your selfie
gameplay,
stick to do it.
yeah. The gameplay is pretty fun. Like, it's very satisfying to just kill tons and tons and tons of zombies. You know, you find blueprints and you just go and, like, vehicles. To get a vehicle combination, all you have to do is find the blueprint, stand between two of those vehicles, and then just hit A and hold it down, essentially, or B or whatever. We were playing it on Xbox One, so I don't think it's on Xbox One. There are maniacs in the game, as there are want to be, as it's a serious staple, but they feel cheaper. Like, you know how in Dead Rising 1, Dead Rising 2, a maniac gets introduced and they're a big deal? Like, they get a cutscene or they, you know, they're terrifying in their own way.
They get a bit of a story beat going as well.
Yeah.
Maybe some motivation why they're doing what they're doing, yeah.
Yeah, that's not in here.
That's very disappointing.
You get to, there was one maniac I got to, and they're just yelling and talking about Christmas or something, and then all these little elves started appearing out of nowhere, and then I killed them, and the guy appeared as Santa, and I killed him. And it wasn't hard, particularly, because you get access to a lot of very powerful games pretty early, very powerful weapons, sorry. A lot of very powerful weapons very early on. And even if you explore a little bit, you can find a Bass and Zero from the Mega Man series. You can find their costumes early on as well. I mean, I like that, but at the same time, to get like the Mega Man costume and the Mega Man Buster, you had to go through a lot of crap in the original Dead Rising. And it made it feel worth it and satisfying. And they're just giving you, like, you go through a town, you're like, oh, here's a Morgan costume. Here's an Akuma costume that they're just giving to me, basically. And that's my main problem with the game, is that, like, you get a weapon called the Blambo pretty early on,
It shoots rockets that explode and kill everything around it, and it's also a crossbow. And it is easily one of the most overpowered weapons you can get in the early game.
Isn't that when the rockets are also fairly accurate, too? They don't just
They're accurate, everywhere. And they stick into enemies.
Yeah. There was, in Dead Rising 2, you could make tubes and fireworks together and make kind of a firework launcher. And the downside of that was it was really inaccurate. So there was some balance there. Lambo
has no weakness. It just, you fire like 3 or 4 shots, it'll kill any boss.
So Dead Rising seems to have gone in the Just Cause direction of game design, where just fuck around and do whatever. Or anything. It'll just be player empowerment fantasy times 1,000. Just do whatever the fuck you want, and the game will accommodate.
Like I got 3 chapters in, and I'd killed almost 8. And I'd killed like 8,000 zombies.
I would say they made their game like that because in the first game, if you took a little bit of damage, you stumbled, and enemies with, like, say, a machine gun could make you stumble forever until you died. So I guess the instead of just removing the stumble, they decided, oh, our battle system's broken, let's just make it unfair. In the other direction.
Yeah.
Incidentally, on the topic of psychos, remember Adam the Clown?
Yeah.
Where he had a whole backstory where he was like a kid's entertainer and he watched all the kids die and get turned into zombies and went insane from it. And you remember the Sniper family where there was like the father and 2 sons, and the father and one of the sons was like, we need to protect this territory from the zombies and stuff, and we need to kill anyone that comes this way, even if they're not a zombie. And the other son was like, I don't really want to do that. And they got a whole cutscene, and it was kind of sad and things because you saw the youngest son getting
browbeaten. No, that's not any.
Yeah, there's...
Yeah, fuck those two. They always appeared during a boss fight or a different boss fight. So, God, I hated those two.
Like, against the Maniacs in Dead Rising 1 or Dead Rising 2, they were a considerable threat. Oh, you were not. You were terrified of them. They took a lot of skill to take down. They took a lot of weapons.
Like, literally the first one in the game, which was Adam the Clown, had probably the best weapon in the game.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Even Dead Rising 3.
You get 3 magazines for it, and it would last the whole game.
Yeah.
So. Even really Dead Rising doing, 3. Yeah. Even Dead Rising 3 had powerful maniacs that actually had cutscenes for him. Here, I'm driving around and I get a call. It's like, oh, hey, I heard some rumors. Go to these areas and you will find a maniac, basically. there's elements of the game that just feel low budget. Hmm. Like, they didn't put that much effort into it. Like, the maniacs and, like, on the plus side, when you save survivors, you don't have to lead them anywhere. You just have to clear the zombies around them, and they can take care of themselves.
Good.
And, they'll upgrade your shelter or whatever nearby. But the shelters all look the same because, again, it's that low-budget feeling.
So if Dead Rising was perhaps Dawn of the Dead mixed with Shaun of the Dead, Dead Rising 4 might be Sharknado.
That's not entirely inaccurate. That's kind of, it's destruction for the sake of destruction. And sure, some of the weapons are cool, but I shouldn't be able to find a key randomly going around, open up this little area, and then just get a laser sword right there.
Okay.
Like, you can find weapons far more powerful than what you can craft really easily, and then there's shops where you can buy those weapons really easily. You don't want to make a vehicle? Well, you can just buy yourself a vehicle. Cool.
That's really disappointing.
You don't want to go find clothing? You can just buy yourself some clothing.
Okay, that one I agree with.
Yeah, that makes sense.
And it was annoying to track down specific outfits anyway.
You can buy maps, so all the collectibles are right there. Which is easy, but like at the same time, it's like you can buy just about anything you need. And it, like, money is easy to come by if you're looking for it.
Yeah, I'm okay with the collectible map. That's another thing that I'm perfectly okay with.
That's a very solid thing to have in a game.
But like food, vehicles, vehicle combinations, weapon combinations, all there. You just buy them.
Like, my thinking was, I get Dead Rising 1 and 2, I think, okay, I'll play these, and then maybe I'll pick up Dead Rising 4 sometime in the future. That, I think I'm good now. I think I'll stick with the ones that scratched an itch that I had, and not just another generic open world where you are effectively god-moding. I'm good.
It's not like there's no difficulty. If you get overwhelmed by zombies, you might be in a little bit of trouble. Or if you get overwhelmed by soldiers, by the way, there's lots of soldiers in certain areas. And they have guns or rocket launchers. If you want to feel even more god mode, there's this new thing called the exosuit.
Oh,
you put it on. And now you've got your power armor that you can upgrade, and you can just rip a parking meter out of the ground and use the cement, attached to the end of it to whack zombies. Granted, that has a limb that has like only 2 minutes you can use it, but it feels unnecessary.
Yeah, no kidding. Yeah. I'm good. I'm good with just regular old Dead Rising. It looks kind of shitty. At the very least, I don't care.
At the very least, it does one thing that I don't think Dead Rising 3 did, where you start off in the mall, and as you advance the story, you slowly open up the open world rather than just being introduced to the entire thing in one go.
Yeah, I think Dead Rising 1 did that to an extent. Like, the mall shutters were down, so you had to find a way around to get to the other side of them so you could open them. That was how that worked.
Yeah, like you complete a story thing, then, okay, you can leave the mall, you can go out, and you can go out into the first part of the town that's around it. If you're looking for a game where you just want to kill lots of zombies, sure, get it on sale. If not, if you want a more fulfilling experience, play the originals.
Dead Rising 1, if you want just like the zombies to be a threat and it actually have some level of difficulty, admittedly frustrating sometimes, but difficulty. The second one, if you want a little bit of the god mode feel, because there is a little bit of that, but still have the time crunch. I haven't played 3, so I can't really speak to that. But yeah.
I mean, there's some zombies that you'll find in Dead Rising 4 that are tougher in some way, and then they start to introduce. I just got to a point where they start to introduce like a mutated version of them that's supposedly stronger, but I didn't really have to even heal after taking them out. So,
yeah.
If it's anything like the special infected from Dead Rising 2, it's just they're just damage sponges. They're not harder. They're just more annoying.
And basically. You also, all healing items are the same now, and you can only carry 2 of them at first, and you can upgrade that later. But yeah, they all heal the same amount.
Ew.
And you can upgrade that amount. So essentially, when I said it was feeling like there was a low budget here, there really was. I mean, even the character models, if you look at their eyes, they're just disgusting.
Also, there's a selfie stick, and that's terrible.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, does it get a regular camera? He's still allowed to be a real photographer, right?
No, it is a regular camera. It just has a selfie mode.
Okay.
It's not like he only has a selfie stick.
That was a concern that I had. Yeah.
It's a regular camera that you can take. You can choose to take a selfie if you so wish.
There isn't like a button where you can, you know, snap off the selfie stick in a fit of pique and hatred for the modern world. Because I feel like that's something that Frank West might actually do. I mean, he's kind of an old school dude. He's like in his late 40s at this point, probably.
He's 52. He's 52 at this point.
Yeah. Because, you know, guy that's not long turned 50 is absolutely going to be getting on the selfie craze. That sounds... Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
To be fair, if there was anyone that would be that old that would jump on that craze, it would be someone whose job it is to use a camera. So, still.
I'd argue that point. I feel like the people that are most like against that sort of, let's say, advancement are the people that have been doing otherwise for the entirety of their careers.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but this is Frank West. He has no shame. Make me popular. This will make me popular, so I have to do it.
So, aside from that, since we were talking about my week,
mm-hmm. Yes, we were.
Christmas Day, we went and we saw Rogue One.
All right, Rogue One.
And
things.
Star Wars Rogue One. It is probably, like, it's not without flaws, but it's probably my favorite Star Wars movie. It is.
That's an interesting choice.
Because, like, you know how when, like, say, DC tries to go dark and then nobody ever smiles? And it's just depressing. The Star Wars movie tries to go dark and realistic, but there's still smiles and there's still very funny characters. And it's just an incredibly likable cast of characters. Yeah, again, there's some nitpicks I have with it, but I like the way they handle everything. Like, say, for example, yeah?
Is there a single Force-sensitive user or Force user in the cast?
There is somebody who is Force-sensitive, but doesn't necessarily use the Force. There's a blind monk.
I think that's where they succeeded in that. Like, the Star Wars universe is interesting, but the Jedi stuff kind of brings it down at this point. It's tired, boring, stuff like that.
Like, he can't use the Force, he wants to be a Jedi, but there's nobody left to train him. Kind of thing. So, he's just this blind monk, and he has this friend who plays basically the straight man, because he's funny, this monk. And it has my favorite droid, KS2O, or whatever his name is. Just call him K. He is like a very competent C-3PO, but more sarcastic and mean, and is great. And it has my favorite ship possibly to be introduced into the film. I won't say what it is, but it's pretty great. And, like, these are a bunch of, like, the characters are a bunch of nobodies, I guess. Like, they're not, there's no chosen one, there's no prophecy. It's these characters are here because of these reasons, and these make sense. And it does some things that actually make me really happy. Like, the rebellion is not all perfect and squeaky clean. It shows some other grayer aspects to them. Like, it really does develop the Star Wars universe.
You know what else about the Star Wars universe?
What?
Never mind. I've had this read before.
Yeah, the extended universe stuff.
Maybe.
Rogue One fits so smoothly into the timeline, and they managed to really just like there's an element of these people would never have their story really told otherwise, and they're not really going to necessarily be renowned as the greatest of heroes or anything. That's Luke's job, but they do something really important, and that's to get the Death Star plans. Essentially, that's the whole point of the movie. It's about that. Also, Darth Vader is in the movie because, you know, they can't not put him in there. And also, it makes sense that he would be there.
Jones is alive, right?
Yes.
He didn't die this year. He didn't happen to die in the past few hours.
No.
Okay. Just had to check.
So,
you never know.
Darth Vader is handled very well, as in he's used very sparingly. But when he does show up, he is probably the scariest version of Darth Vader I've seen. Like, because there's nobody with a lightsaber to possibly, you know,
stop him,
fight him off if he decides to, you know, start killing people.
It's nice we get to see this side of him, because with Luke, it was the earlier movies, so they didn't really know they didn't find their groove yet. And it's, you always kind of get the impression he was holding back because it's his son, sort of.
Yeah.
Wait, but you think they found their groove in the prequel movies?
Nah, not really. As far as combat goes, they still barely knew what they were doing.
Oh, okay.
That's what I meant.
But when Darth Vader decides, oh yeah, time to fight the rebellion, and he shows up, you run. You don't fight him. You can't win. How can you fight him? You have no weapons that would work. Because he's really powerful, basically.
Honestly, I'm on board for this. This is like someone beating a bunch of children. a full grown man just fighting children.
He has like one real, like, I would call it action scene, but it's one of the coolest action scenes I've ever seen Darth Vader in. Simply because of just he's fighting children, basically. As far as like the cast is well constructed, there's fun in the movie, which I really walked into that movie and I genuinely enjoyed it. And I was really happy with what it was. I mean, I can't really talk spoilers because have any of you guys seen it yet?
Nope.
No.
Also, I don't think it's been out for 2 weeks, so.
Yeah. But, yeah, they've done it, you know? There's no prequel stupidity here. And I like elements of this better than Force Awakens, because Force Awakens is episode 4 of V2. And I can't really compare this to any of the other movies. It made me feel happy. It made me feel sad. Good movie.
I like the explanation. I forget who said it. It was either someone from Rooster Teeth or it was the Nostalgia Critic, but it was like, Episode 7 was like if they were saying, okay, let's prove that we can make a good Star Wars movie. So they make, admittedly, a retread, but they make a good Star Wars movie in retreading Episode 4, basically. And for Rogue One, they're like, okay, we've shown we know what we're doing. Let's make our Star Wars movie kind of thing.
Yeah. Huh? And boy, is it good. We see new ships we haven't seen before. There's land battles. There's epic space battles. They've managed to recreate the aesthetics of the original trilogy in terms of like how the Empire's ships and stuff are designed. It looks really good. I genuinely like it. A lot.
I'd say I might
aside
see
from
it,
that,
but I won't.
Aside from that, Christmas happened, and I got things. So I got the PlayStation VR, everybody.
Great.
Is it good? Does it work?
It's fantastic. It blew my mind. Like, there's no other experience like it. But if you have PlayStation VR Worlds...
I'm sure there is another experience like it, and it might possibly be called the Vive and or the Oculus.
Yeah, but you don't... I'm talking about VR in general when I say that. But,
okay, and then it might be called the Vive or the Oculus.
Yeah, there's no other experience like VR.
Oh, right. Okay.
Like,
he means that as a whole, yeah.
Right. Okay.
And if you get PlayStation VR Worlds, don't play that Space Odyssey thing. There's a game in there that's clearly not optimized. Because everything else in that game is optimized for VR. Like, oh, wow, this is cool. Oh, wow, a shark's going to attack me. Oh, man, I look around and I'm like in another world because this thing is made really well. And then you get to Space Odyssey and it's like, yeah, drive this like spider mech or whatever and go around and look around and move at a very fast speed. And normally a cockpit would sort of ground you. But I don't know what they did, but I just felt nauseous for hours after playing that. But yeah, VR is good. It's amazing. I kind of was really happy with it. My dad got to play Batman VR, Arkham VR, and he squealed when he saw he was Batman.
I will never, ever be able to play VR in an area where other people can physically access me. I just have no trust in my family not digging with me.
Yeah.
Oh, I got messed with a few times on the VR helmet. Yeah. Shooting a gun in VR is really accurate. Like, really accurate. You just... There's no, like, separation between you and the controller, and there's no recoil or anything. Like, you look, and then you can be like, okay, I'm going to shoot there. And so it's accurate in a weird way. Because I have the move controllers, too. So it's just like, aim, shoot. Works fine. Very accurate. Not going to say much more on VR, because it's probably already been talked about by a lot of other people. And if you don't have VR, give it a whirl. It's really cool. Don't try any of that low phone VR or whatever.
But do they have different genres between the ones that you sit and the ones you can move around in for VR? Or
some games have a sit or standing option. I don't think you have to stand in all the games, but I stood anyways. Made me feel like I was more into it.
That makes sense.
Aside from that, I also got Dishonored 2, Titanfall 2, and Dragon Ball Fusions. I haven't played any of them but Dishonored 2, and I only played like the first mission of Dishonored 2, so I can't really give my full thoughts on it yet. But boy, does Corvo sound edgy.
Yeah, he didn't talk in the first game, did he?
No. When he talks, he sounds like he's being edgy to the point where I find it funny.
Hmm. Well, I don't know which ending is canon, but he either murdered thousands of people or did sneaky stuff. So, yeah.
I get the feeling that the darker ending is canon because Corvo's story is all about murdering all the people, or it's supposed to be in the second game. Like, he is the murder happy one, and the girl, whose name I forget because I don't actually care about the characters, is more of the stealthy, just get past everyone.
Oh, that's actually how I was going to play it, so that works.
I'm going to be playing it the opposite way.
Oh, okay.
I'm playing as Corvo right now, and I'm going to try to be as non-lethal as possible. When I switch to the other girl, I'm going to be as murderous as possible, because in the original, I played both sides, and when you get to the very murderous at the end, the girl's like, we should just kill them all! And I'm like, yeah, that's the girl I'm going to go with.
That was the best goddamn thing ever. The girl was like 9. She's like, kill them all.
And I'm just like, all right, cool. I guess this is what's going to be my canon protagonist now.
Ellie?
Emily?
Emily.
That was it. Yeah. Thank you.
Haven't started Dragon Ball Fusions. Looking forward to it. Titanfall 2 will take a while to update. So I'm not...
About Fusions. Yeah.
Me too. Hence why I asked for it. I also got The Disaster Artist book. For those of you who don't know, The Disaster Artist is the behind-the-scenes story of The Room. You know that movie, The Room?
Yep.
And it's written by Greg Sestero's, or somebody else who helped him with editing or something.
Greg Sestero's was Mark.
Yes.
As in, hi, Mark.
Oh, hi, Mark.
Yeah, it was him.
Yeah. He's writing it from his point of view, basically. And how he met with Tommy and how he got conned into being in to this movie.
Yeah.
So I'm looking forward to really cracking that one open. I tried to watch The Room with my parents, but did not realize how much dirtiness was in the beginning.
There is a sex scene in I think it's the third scene of the film. It's a sex scene.
In the first 3 minutes, it is a 5-minute long sex scene.
Yep, and it very, very clearly shows whatever his name is, Tommy Wiseau's bare naked ass, and it's not good.
I had to turn it off because they started to do another dirty scene, and my mom's like, stop, this is a porno, and I'm like, I'm sorry, Mom. Why are you trying to make us watch a porno, a bad porno made by these two dudes? I'm like, that's not what it's about. I'm sorry, Mom. So, okay. I had to deal with that. I got a variety. I got a variety of other weird things, like a ice scraper that's coming out of like a furry like wolf claw, and it's supposed to keep your arm warm when you put your hand in the little claw, and it has like an ice scraper at the end of it. I got socks, pajama pants, lots and lots of candy, a lot of candy, too much candy, a keyboard vacuum. Also, ooh, I didn't know these things exist. That will actually help out a lot to have a keyboard vacuum. And that's about it for my week. I mean, I haven't really done anything other than just try to play my games that I've gotten and look forward to the fact that when this comes out, I will be at work. Probably. Oh, no. I'll be working the day of New Year's Eve. So that's going to be fun.
Yeah. Okay. Patient, are you there?
Yes.
Hello.
Just a sec.
Okay.
You have to be very patient.
All right. So, my turn then?
Yes.
Well, here's a riddle for you. What's black and white and sunny?
Black, white, and sunny?
Yes.
The weather outside, I guess?
What's a black play into that?
The rotten weather. Eggs.
My Christmas sunny side presents. Up.
Oh, okay.
My parents bought me Pokemon Black, Pokemon White, and Pokemon Sun for Christmas.
Wow.
Okay.
Yeah, it surprised me too. I was expecting one of the three, not all of them. It's going to be difficult to play all of them, I think.
Yeah, I was only expecting one game aside from the PlayStation VR. I was not expecting to get all the crap that I did.
Aside from that, I got a few good books, including a calendar for authors, a writer's block notebook. It should be rather useful in the near future. But I think that the thing that I like most, my brother and sister got me something. They've been planning this for months. Apparently they stumbled onto it months ago. And do you know what that is?
It looks like a mosaic of Luffy.
Yes, it is. It's a 1,000-piece jigsaw puzzle that forms into a mosaic of Luffy.
Are those all little pictures?
Yes, they are.
They're framed from the show?
Yep.
That's amazing.
Oh, yes. My sibling, I really love puzzles. This is going to be all kinds of fun once I have somewhere to work on it.
Sounds fun.
Very much so. So, Christmas was wonderful. Great presents, great reactions from others when they opened the presents that I got them. A wonderful dinner and a very good time at church. Church was easily the highlight of it.
Oh, really?
Now that's unexpected.
And,
I mean, my church I go to is a pretty big
Christmas
church.
Christmas was good altogether. And
like a concert.
Well, aside from that, this week, this past week, the Cross published the next chapter of this bite, the conclusion of the post-Denny's lobby arc. And I'm glad that you appreciated that little shout out we did, Casey.
Yeah, it was nice.
That was a shout out.
Was it to the Fandomflux or Casey?
Both.
I just say hello everybody and welcome to the SBS broadcast episode 493.
Ah.
I was very touched. It was a nice gesture. Thank you for that.
It's our pleasure, we assure you. So,
we'll never get the 493.
Shut up, we might. You don't know.
Yeah, the number was a different shout out altogether. Aside
Pokemon,
from that,
I'm assuming.
What was that?
Pokemon, I'm assuming.
Yeah, it was the end of the fourth saga of One Piece, so we put the last number in the fourth generation.
That's actually pretty smart.
My idea.
I'm surprised I actually figured that out. Okay. We're on a similar wavelength, it's weird. Okay.
You're only just now noticing. So aside from that, lots of updates this week from good stories that I'm keeping up with. Enjoying reading through all of them again and again. And, oh yeah, that reminds me. For the past week, we've been taking care of my cousin's pug and miniature pincher while she and her family visiting her mother up in Dallas. They're a bit troublesome.
They are small dogs. That's kind of their whole thing.
Okay. Patient, your voice has gone from Microsoft Sam to, I'm thinking, Heath Ledger's Joker a little bit.
He's slowly becoming more and more villainous.
Yeah.
As his voice drops lower and lower.
I repeat, I hate flu season. I never get sick otherwise, but allergies always hit me this time of year.
My father was a
Do you think he's going to drop into Bane at some point?
A fiend.
I think you're going to drop into Bane at this rate.
Sorry.
try laughing, but I'm pretty sure that that would trail off into a series of coughing, so I'm not going to try.
I could relate to that. Fair enough.
Okay.
Not pleasant. Okay, so anything else this week for me? Enjoying time at home, enjoying... well, the year as a whole, looking back, has been one of the best of my life. I mean, it was at the start of this year that I joined the Crossbrain, and that's easily the second best thing that's ever happened to me. So, following the journey of this bites all the way to the end of the year when we finally reach the top 10 and we're only 3 favorites away from reaching 9th place. It's rather wonderful.
Yeah.
Oh, and I finally learned how to tie a Windsor knot this week, so that's nice.
Yeah, I did that this year too. But I'm like 7 years older than you, so it's a little bit more embarrassing, but, you know, whatever.
I mean, I still don't know how to do that, and I don't really intend to learn, so there you go.
Ties are sort of a standard part of church attire for me, so had to learn at one point or another, and finally got around to learning it now, so that's good for me.
Mine was for an interview. Like, when I got that 3 hours warning that I was going to be in an interview that day, 1 hour of that was learning how to tie a tie.
You mentioned that, actually. Settled down to watch videos of people making tying ties.
Yep. Yeah. Okay. Anything else, patient?
Well, I've posted one more recipe here.
Oh, yes, you did.
That's my brother's fiance's grandmother invented it by accident a while back. Her surname is Crutz, C-R-U-T-S, hence the name. It's a pretty simple recipe. They usually only make it around Christmas time, but, well, it's really good stuff, so...
Better just to check. You're not giving away any family secret recipes or anything, are you?
No.
Okay.
No. If it was a secret, I'm sure I would have heard as much by now.
Okay. Just wanted to check.
No. Yeah, it's pretty simple. Okay, so I believe that's everything for now, so I'm now going to give my voice a rest.
Okay, then. Slicer, what have you done this week?
Not a whole hell of a lot, really. For Christmas, I got Cold Hard Cash, the best gift.
Wow! That's like 7 times better than regular gifts.
I know, right? It's the freedom to get whatever the hell I want. It's like a gift card, only better.
Yeah!
But, I'm not even being sarcastic. I actually really like getting money for Christmas.
No, I understand. I know several people who just want money.
People feel weird about giving money, but just like, no, I can get what I want instead of having to put on a fake smile, usually.
I'm always happy to receive whatever crap is given to me.
Fair enough.
It usually tends to be pretty okay. I mean, hey, my mom was happy when I made her a little angel for her tree that had my face on it.
That sounds pretty great, actually.
Because I made one of those when I was in kindergarten, and she put it up on the fireplace. I was like, I'm going to make a bigger one and put my face on it. Mm-hmm. I have this, like, this, just the perfect face. I'm like, hey! It's great.
Okay.
That's a present you can give your mom. Put your face on an angel with an A kind of face.
I'll keep that in mind. Beyond that, I got more Steam games, which puts my Steam budget at like $80.
Oh boy.
Yeah.
Any recommendations?
No. That's the next part. I have thus returned like $30 worth of that, which is about 10 games. And Steam has even given me a warning that it's like, hey, you've accepted or you've requested a lot of refunds. So we're not going to let you do that anymore for a while unless you have good reason. So I'm not sure how serious that warning is or if it's just automated. Because I always give reasons. I give like a paragraph of text for every return, but
it's going to be automated. But yeah, they're going to be more critical of your refund request from now on.
Yeah, that's fun.
Because you will now have a flag against your profile, basically.
Mm. I hope that goes away at some point, because like,
if it says it will in the warning, then it will. But you know, for the time being.
Yeah. But one of those returns was, in fact, Naruto Full Blitz 3. I forgot how stupid the Naruto battle system is. It is effectively a one-button fighter, and the enemy knows every move and can execute them instantly.
Yay!
Whereas I have to press buttons in order to set up the move, a spacing has to be perfect, and movement is clunky at best.
So, hooray for fairness.
Yeah.
I liked it.
So that was returned. At least that was quite a bit of money back to me. That was $18 for the whole thing. Which, as far as my price range goes, that's like hitting the top. I usually don't get anything more than $20. Unless it's a big purchase. Like, I think I bought XCOM for full price. XCOM 2, specifically.
Hmm.
Oh, speaking of XCOM 2, I finally fucking figured out how to mod that game. So I've been enjoying
it. Super easy to mod that game.
Yeah, I knew how. It's just the game kept pulling values from places that I didn't know existed. So I'd mod half the files and nothing would change. So I've been enjoying a nice campaign where my soldiers never miss, ever.
Good. It's like they're actual soldiers.
Yeah, so I decided to bump it up to what is effectively hard mode in that game, and it's actually pretty fair. Like, I hit every time.
As long as you never miss.
Well, yeah. So, the thing is, you don't do really enough damage unless you focus on weapons, but then you take a bunch of health damage and your soldiers die. So, it's kind of a delicate balance there, but it is actually fair, even with that advantage.
So, it's that advantage that would fix the game.
Yeah, it does, actually. I can see where some people would be bored of it, but, like, I'm having a blast, so.
Because, like, I don't want to play XCOM ever again after that nonsensical, there's an 80% shot, but we miss, and now the entire team dies.
Or a shotgun shot from 2 feet away misses.
Because that actually happened, yep.
That happened.
God damn it, even F.
Yep.
Like the accuracy doesn't really add anything. Just if you change, like if you take it away, it doesn't add anything to the gameplay. I feel like it just makes it more difficult because of RNG.
I can say the lack of aiming actually makes it feel more tense, because a lot of missions, when it actually ramps up the difficulty, you feel outnumbered easily because enemies just appear at the worst time. So, like, you know you can hit them, and you know exactly how much damage you're going to do, roughly, unless you get a critical. So, yeah, it adds the tenseness to me.
Yeah. All right.
I don't think I've actually done anything else. So, yeah, that was about it.
Cool.
Just a lot of... Oh, right. My sleep schedule is absolutely fucked. As it tends to do whenever I don't have any obligations. So I'm sleeping at like 10 a.m. and waking up at around dinner at 5 or 6. And yeah, the downside of having so many friends that are either A, on the other side of the planet, or B, nocturnal. And myself being nocturnal as well. So that's just what my sleep schedule defaults to.
Yeah.
So, yep, that's it.
Kenshi's online. he's probably not going to jump in, but you know. Anyway.
Oh, hey, Arxim is online, but idle.
Yeah, so I don't know. I told him he can jump in if he wants to. All right, so the next thing we have is the other thing that is the anime. Mahoka Koko Retose.
The regular at the Magic Academy or whatever.
Yeah, that's basically, yeah.
So, you know, there's always this basic premise that people like to go back to, yep. Which is this character is at this Magic Academy, but they're different from everyone else. Why? Because they're actually really strong, even if it doesn't seem like they are.
Yeah, they don't seem strong, but they're really strong, so they get to show off in probably the second episode.
Now,
in fact, in this case, it is in fact the second episode.
Now, the thing about this show, and the thing about that type of genre and why it continues to exist, is because normally there's something different. There's something unique to that adds to the series, whether it be something about the setting or the main characters and the character interactions are just very fun and enjoyable to the point where, like, okay, the premise is boring, but I like these characters. So, okay. Or there's some deeper plot.
Yep.
Now, the first episode doesn't do that.
Yeah, has none of that.
The main character is boring. Very boring.
He seems like an engineer, which is appropriate because he is an engineer, but that doesn't make for a fun character. The sister wants to fuck him, and that's about all the characterization she gets. And there are friend characters. One of them is the guy
just out of nowhere.
And there is one who is the tomboy, and there is one who is the buxom glasses wearing person.
Pure girl.
Sure. Let's go with that. And there is the arsehole. Those are your characters. Your dramatis personae for this first episode.
Yay. Yeah. So, there's some elements, like, it starts off, when it started off, I was like, okay, this is, you might have me with something. It's like, oh yeah, World War III broke out because, you know, of food shortages and there's only 3 billion people left alive. I'm like, okay, that's kind of interesting. I wonder what you're going to do with that.
Nothing.
The answer is nothing.
So that was disappointing because that was all just the set of a Magic Academy.
Yep.
And have the main character be awesome because isn't he like a war vet or something?
Yeah, apparently. He is.
Okay, so we'll do the synopsis, and then we'll spoil the shit out of the actual show at the end of it, so if people are worried about spoilers, they can skip ahead a little bit into the actual topic that we're going to be doing later. So, as has been mentioned, it starts with an opening narration scroll, effectively, which is, World War III happened. There was a shortage of energy and food and resources, basically. So World War III happened. The population gets cut down to a fraction of itself. Like, I think we're at 7, closing on 8 billion at this point, so it's like 2/5 of the world's population survives. And magic becomes scienced, basically, and turns into effectively another science. Somehow. So it just becomes a science, which means it's no longer magic, but they call it magic anyway, for reasons. And then we skip ahead, and there is a school, and it is a very fancy school. And you're super awesome if you get into this school, but there is also a class segregation of the students in this school. There are the quote, blooms, which have, like, a shoulder patch, which looks like a snowflake, actually, more than a flower, but, you know, whatever. And there are the weeds that don't have this patch on the shoulder.
Yeah. What is their actual designation? Or is it weeds? I thought that was the, like, saying muggle.
I don't know. It's probably
irregulars or something.
Yeah, that's
it. I don't know.
Yeah, irregulars. Yeah, so main character is an irregular, a weed, and his sister, who wants to fuck him, just to be clear about that, is a bloom, and she is super awesome, and she gives the opening speech for incoming students, or matriculating students, which...
And she wants to have sex with her brother.
She does.
Like, really hard.
Yeah. What's his name? The super awesome guy that's supposed to look not awesome. Sitting in the back, and he gets accosted by other people that are supposed to be not awesome. Then we move on to something. I watched this like a couple days ago, and it's all just sort of gone.
I watched this morning, and it's not that memorable.
Yeah. I think there was a class scene next, and awesome guy is like, I just want to be like a designer, engineer person.
There's one part where it's like, oh, she can see my aura. I have to protect my secret. And I'm like, it's a secret that you're actually super awesome? Okay. We already know that.
And there's a scene where the sister is accosted by the student council, and the student council's like, hey, you should be hanging out with us and not your shitty brother who is shitty because he's shit. And she's like,
really, I don't understand the logic there of this is my brother, so
I can go hang fuck out yourself kind of thing. Yeah.
Yeah. It's literally like, I'm going to sit with my brother. Nobody should be able to stand in the way of that.
Yeah. So there is also a cafeteria scene, and, exactly that happens also. The student council show up again, and they're like, let's try and split up a brother and sister for no reason, because we're assholes. And then pretty much nothing happens, and there's a scene where they're going home, and the asshole from the student council shows up and is like, hey, stop hanging out with your brother, because you're better than him. The logic
which makes no sense
in the show anyway, and
deadbeats should be lonely or something.
Yeah. And the super awesome guy is like, okay, you want to fight, let's fucking do this kind of thing. And that's where the episode ends.
Now I had mentioned that I had dropped this series. I had tried it and I had dropped it. Originally, this thing was a light novel. And the light novel. Yeah, I am. You know, I tend to find that you'll get the more purest, better form of what the anime is in the light novel, because they include things like characters' thoughts, motivations, and whatnot.
Yeah, where most of that stuff is just inferred in an anime.
And so, and I like to read, so it works out pretty well. The light novel for this is not better. It's not. There is nothing here, actually. In fact, because of the format of it coming from a light novel, heck, even the light novel, there's no real hook. That's the problem. I was expecting, like, you know, what would be good at the end of the episode to tie it to the beginning? War starts breaking out. Oh no, another war. You know, something just unexpected and crazy that starts the story in a direction.
Something that gives us a plot beyond, school hijinks.
Because that's what we would need to actually elevate this story to the point where it would be interesting.
Yeah, that was my problem with it, basically, was it's just boring. I lasted like five episodes. It's just, I can't even remember specifically why I dropped it. I just stopped watching an episode, did something else, and never came back.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's supposed to be funny when the sister goes into a, oh, Oni-chan, you think stuff about me? And I think it's supposed to be funny, but it's not at all. It's just kind of there.
I mean, yeah. there's been examples of, like, in comedy, you need your silly person, your straight man.
Mm. And everyone's a straight man in this show. Literally everyone.
Yeah. You could have the sister be the silly person and have the brother be the straight man, and that mechanic between the two would actually work out.
Mm.
Like, but instead, I don't get it. It's just boring.
They're both just also flat. I mean, we've had a show where they did the brother-sister dynamic, where, oh, the sister really wants to, you know, ride the brother, basically. And they played it for laughs, and it worked a lot. Like, I forget what the show was called, but
yeah,
it was successful at doing that, and this show doesn't even seem to try.
I mean, also forget the name of that, and I was just about to mention it. But the brother just flat out says no every time the girl, the sister, does things, and that was hilarious.
Yeah, it was.
And that did it so much better.
Good time.
I really wonder. I need to know what that is so I can rewatch at least the first episode.
It was the first half an episode, and then it became harem hijinks. But it's in a previous episode. We could probably find it without too much trouble.
The only thing like more tropey was if you were to fight a fire type magic user who was the top of her class and beat her because he was actually super awesome all along. That happens a lot.
In this case, no, I'm going to spoil the next episode. He fights the arsehole guy, and he punches him out in a second.
Yeah, I expected as much. Yeah. And even in that trope of tropes, you can still salvage the series by having good characters. Like, as long as there's something that compels you to keep watching, which there isn't in this case.
Oh, sorry, there was another characterization moment between the tomboy and the guy, and it's, oh, they're fighting, they're arguing, immediately.
They must be close friends.
Yeah, or, oh, they're already fighting and bickering like an old married couple.
Yeah.
Yeah. So,
unlike with Piano, I actually watched this at normal speed. I regret that decision.
Yeah, it probably was a mistake. I mean, okay, we're going to get back to actually talking about other elements of the show, but spoilers, the awesome guy, who's, you know, secretly awesome, is apparently, he created a magic where he regenerates, so he is effectively immortal. So, probably not actually brother and sister. That's pretty much it. That's the reason why he's immortal, is he regenerates, and that means he can't do other magic because it's too costly. So, yeah, there's your big twist. Do you care?
No.
Mm.
Do they ever
there's nothing
check
interesting. There's nothing interesting you can do with that power.
Not really, no.
If you have one power, like, I know I'm probably the only person here who's watched JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, but in JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, you have the stands, and the stands can only typically do like one thing.
Yep.
And it's figuring out how to use that one thing in a way that you can defeat your enemy.
For the record, I've seen season one of JoJo's Bizarre Adventure.
Oh boy, that's the most boring season. Go watch part two.
Always great when it starts off with the most boring part of the show.
Well, because that was like the very beginning when the creator was getting, like, was starting to get into the series, and they improve dramatically as the series goes on.
Okay.
Well, what about the theme song? You can't deny that that was awesome, right?
The theme song is amazing, but I'm talking about, like, the original manga. If you look at the original manga for part one of JoJo, it's very messy. Just in general, like part one is
okay. Before we end up talking about JoJo, which is not why we're here,
I would talk about JoJo for a long time. I know you would stop me, so thank you.
I know you would.
Yeah, watch this next role actually end up on JoJo.
I really hope not. Also, you still need to send me the thing. So the animation for this is nothing to write home about. It's fairly standard. There weren't any like fight scenes, so I'm assuming where all the budget went, which is always the fight scenes. You know, we haven't seen that yet, and we're not going to, because we're not going to watch another fucking episode.
Yeah. The budget did, in fact, go into the fight scenes. They look pretty good, all things considered, but yeah.
Yeah. I mean, like, the color palette was interesting. It's sort of a pale green and blue kind of thing, and white just everywhere. That's interesting. It's not something you see all the time, but it also just makes it look kind of washed out and even more dull, surprisingly enough.
I'd blame this boringness on it being a light novel, and you know, it's meant to be like at a much faster pace or something, but I've seen light novel animes that are handled very well and are actually written in a way that would be acceptable. Like having a hook somewhere near the beginning.
Or anywhere.
Yeah. I don't like it when the premise of your show, the main hook, is the premise of your character is powerful. Watch them be awesome. Because that's like, there's nothing interesting there. Mm-hmm. Unless you can, I don't know, have interesting characters or have the power be like a, like, you know, even One Punch Man, where it's like, I'm too powerful.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
I was going to say, like, have a twist on it, like, the power is a curse in some sense, whether metaphorical or very, very real and material.
Like, I know we watched Noblesse a while back. In Noblesse, there are some serious drawbacks to his power, even though he's seriously overpowered. And those play in later, and that's interesting. I have other problems with that series, but that's not one of them. So can we just roll another one and move past this?
I think so. I mean, I was gonna bring up like other aspects, like we should review all aspects of a show if we're gonna watch it, like sound, but there was no notable sound work to speak of, whether effects or music or
yeah,
even the dialogue, because everything was so flat and boring. So,
Casey, one quick question before we begin. Mm-hmm. Is it starting with this one or the next one that we are resetting the repeat?
Still in December.
It's next one we will have our vetoes back.
Yep.
I'm not asking about vetoes.
Oh, sorry.
I'm asking about the repeats. I mean, if we roll this one sometime in the coming year, will we have to look back into it?
Oh no, never again.
No repeats whatsoever.
I'm not sure what you mean. Do we reset all the ones that have already come up? No, we've already seen them.
Yes, yeah. That's... Oh, all right.
We've given our full thoughts. I don't think they're going to change.
Yeah.
Okay, so just mark it off the list then.
Pretty much.
Got it.
All right, let's see what we get.
27? I have to do this because Kenshi's not here.
Huh. Mm-hmm. Wait, wouldn't that be Z? Or X?
No, just roll the 27 to see what comes up. That's...
Oh, okay. Yeah. I thought that was the number you got.
No.
Yeah, I was like, oh, wow. We're starting at the bottom. Hope we get Zoids.
Oh, wait, yeah, I'm supposed to be rolling, aren't I? Because that's what Kenshi does. Shit, I'm back.
Yeah. What are you doing? I'll tell you what, I'll roll for you. How about that?
I got it.
I'm going to roll.
I got it.
Okay, 15.
Shut up, I'm doing it. 6.
15.
The number is 6, it's E.
F.
No, E. Sorry, you're right. Numbers come first. 20.
20. Alrighty.
Wow.
5.
5. And the winner is Eden of the East.
Oh, hey. Something I actually know.
I know this one came up before, but I think we might have vetoed it. So, which means it's
back in rotation. I know of this.
All right.
I haven't actually, I don't think I've seen this one, but I've heard of it, as in I've seen the title before.
Likewise. I mean, ditto. I keep getting those confused.
Zoroark.
There should be another. There should be like an evolution of ditto that's called likewise. Like a baby version of it. Anyway.
On November 22nd, 2010, Japan was hit by missile strikes, a terrorist act that fortunately did not harm anyone, becoming known as Careless Monday. Quickly forgotten, society goes on about their lives as normal. Quickly forgotten. During her graduation trip to America 3 months later, friendly college student Saki Morimi's life is forever changed when she finds herself saved from unexpected trouble by Akira Takizawa. Takizawa is cheerful, but odd in many ways. He is stark naked and suffers from amnesia, believing himself to be a terrorist. In addition, he possesses a strange cell phone loaded with 8.2 billion yen in digital cash. Despite Takizawa's suspicious traits, Saki quickly befriends the enigmatic young man. However, unbeknownst to her, this is the beginning of a thrilling death game involving money, cell phones, and the salvation of the world. Higashi no Eden chronicles Saki's struggle to unravel the mysteries behind her savior, while Takizawa himself battles other individuals armed with similar cell phones and returning memories which reveal his possible connection to the event from months ago.
Well, it's a good thing we're already bored out of our minds, because I remembered I actually have seen this one, and God, is it boring.
Oh, so joy. Have fun with that. I was already thinking it might be based on the plot summary, but, you know, okay.
I will admit, there are a few interesting points, and if they aren't in the first episode, I will reveal them when we do this, but...
I was thinking, oh, hey, you know, there's, like, a hook. Something interesting that happens, at least.
Vaguely.
Maybe? I mean, a guy appears naked with a cell phone claiming to be a terrorist. So, I don't know. But, like, I have a problem with the fact that Japan was hit by missile strikes. Nobody was harmed, so everybody just forgot about
it. Yeah, no one died, so no one cares. Even though missile strikes happened.
That's like the type of thing where immediately everybody would be like, we're under attack, we need to go find out who did this.
Yeah.
I don't know how I feel about that.
No harm, no foul has a limit, right? Like, there's apparently a point where that doesn't fly anymore.
Apparently that limit is past missile barrage, so...
We get hit by missiles, you're going to be looking at somebody to declare war with.
Mm. I'd say die missile barrage, but no one did, so that doesn't make sense. That joke wouldn't work. That's
die missile barrage.
Yeah. Except don't die missile barrage. I'm just gonna drop that.
Live missile barrage.
Yeah, sure, why not? So
just let me mod the values of those missiles and they'll never miss again.
Yeah. Cheetah.
Missiles are meant to miss. That's why they're called missiles.
There we go. So this will be we're watching. This will be what we're watching. Eden of the East. If you've watched it before and you like it, okay.
Second autocomplete from Google. Why are missiles called missiles? Charles through the aerospace, known as a missile, guided missile, powered on guided munition, is known as a rocket. Okay, that doesn't tell me
probably
why.
The casing. It's probably named after the casing it's housed in or something. I don't know.
Anyways,
missiles are guided, rockets are not, is what it tells me, and that's about it. So
can we move on?
I was curious.
It comes from the Latin verb mittere, meaning to send.
Ah.
Okay. Oh, like a letter.
Patient just proved his own point wrong.
Only more explosive, yes. Well, okay,
his previous point was a joke, though, Casey. I don't understand. Okay, whatever.
Moving on for the sake of sanity. Casey, do we have time for topics?
How long have we been going?
I feel like we probably should. Shit. I mean,
we've been going for a lot longer than I expected us to. Okay. 2016 is the topic. That is literally the only topic we have on the docket, so why not? Might end up being a long episode. I don't really care. Call it a new year special.
Did you guys hear that Carrie Fisher died recently?
And then her mom died setting up after. A funeral?
Yeah.
How's that family working out? I feel so bad for them.
You apparently don't, because you apparently felt the need to joke about it, and I felt the need to laugh, and I feel like shit.
That's what this year has done to us.
This year is a joke, because everybody's dying. Literally everybody.
So, if we're going to do this, let's do this. I actually pulled up a list of all the people that died this year.
Jesus.
There is a list.
We're going to be here for an hour.
It is extensive. Starting in January, David Bowie passed away from cancer at the age of 69. I am still super bummed about this. Likewise, Alan Rickman, age 69. Terry Wogan, no one on this podcast is going to know who he is, but he was awesome. Died at age 77. Oh, sorry. Sir Terry Wogan. He was knighted. Harper Lee, the author of To Kill a Mockingbird, died 89 years old. I'm going to skip the comedians that no one else is going to heard of because they're British.
Joe Alasky, age 63, who did the voice of Bugs Bunny, Daffy Duck, and other Looney Tunes characters, died in February.
David Guest died at 62. More American British comedians rather. Prince. I know Kenshi was sad about this. In April he passed away at the age of 57, which yeah. That sucks.
Sucks a lot.
Yeah.
Did Monty Ohm pass this year or
no,
was that...
that was like 2014.
Okay. Yeah, that was a while ago.
Yeah. Muhammad Ali, 73 years old. Everyone here knows who Muhammad Ali is, right? No one's that out of touch.
Hey, you know Tony Burton, the guy who played Apollo Creed's boxing trainer in Rocky? He died.
Oh. Is that the punchline for this year? He died. Or she died. Remember so-and-so? They died.
Yeah.
The guy who played Hawk on the 1990s American Gladiator, he died.
Anton Yelchin. Yeah. That was actually a really sad one. Because he was cool.
Lee Riekerman died.
He was
the guy who played Hawk on the Gladiator.
Oh, I've forgotten the name of the character. What was the name of his character? I feel really bad now, but he was the Russian one from the new Star Trek films.
Oh, yeah.
He was... Like, he seemed like he could have done a lot of really cool stuff in Hollywood, and 27 years old, and he gets crushed by his gait, if memory serves. Car accident.
Frank Sinatra Jr. died at 72 in March.
Kenny Baker, the man behind R2-D2, passed away.
Mm-hmm.
Gene Wilder, Willy Wonka, the original, passed away, age of 83.
Yeah. He had, like, Alzheimer's or something.
Pete Burns, who I'm going to have to actually tell people who he was because he, it's before your time, but...
Wait. Is he the one who wrote You Spin Me Round Like a Record?
Singer for Dead or Alive.
As of that song.
Yep. He passed away at 57.
China also died.
The wrestler?
Yeah.
Oh.
Huh.
She died the day before Prince.
Oh, yeah, I remember that. Her life story is really rough. Leonard Cohen.
There's a long list of people who died.
Leonard Cohen. Most famous for Hallelujah. Yes, that Hallelujah. Passed away. Rick Parfitt from Status Quo. Passed away at 68. George Michael. Literally 2 days after we talked about him on the podcast, which made me a little concerned.
Look, we're not Rooster Teeth. We don't have the power to kill people via conversation.
It wasn't just conversation. Ken wanted to put, like, Last Christmas... I had to tell him not to put Last Christmas, the song, in the fucking episode because of copyright stuff. And, yeah, he died on Christmas Day at 53 years old.
Kimbo Slice, I don't know if we mentioned him. He died 42 on June. Kimbo Slice.
Yep. And then we're back to December with Carrie Fisher and Debbie Reynolds. Mother and daughter died one day apart.
There is a long list of people who died. Extended version. These are just...
Yep. I did, in fact, go for the truncated version. And I missed a few that you would never have heard of because they're British.
Yep. There's...
Pull up the list for 2015 and just compare the sizes of them.
No, I don't need to be more depressed about this. Also,
I'm curious if they are the same size and we're just... It's current, so it's hitting harder, or if there's actually been a lot more deaths.
I feel like a lot more, like, big celebrities died this year.
I missed out someone that was not on that list that I was reading. Ron Glass, the who played Shepherd Book on Firefly. And a bit more of a deep cut, he also played God's Cousin Rod on the show Teen Angel for Disney Channel. But, yeah. He was fantastic, by the way. And, he passed away this year. I don't like 2016.
2016 was rough, taking out however many it can as it ends the year.
I don't know. I mean, I got a girlfriend this year, but, I mean, we're broken up now, so fuck. Oh, I'm depressed again. Oh, the one hope spot, and then nope.
And I mean, we don't even have to talk about the election.
Oh, God. And the referendum.
That happened this year.
Drop
Brexit. God.
I mean, we had some fun Marvel movies, right?
Okay, that's true.
Yeah.
That is actually true.
I guess. I mean, we got Luke Cage this year. That was cool. So,
yeah.
And as I said, this whole year has been me joining with the Crossbrain. I mean, I joined at the start of this year, and my one-year anniversary is coming up this coming month, so I really can't complain.
That's pretty awesome.
For us, we've expanded our podcast to have a bigger rotating cast.
Yeah, I started writing seriously again this year. Mostly because I lost my job this year, but, you know, swings and roundabouts, I guess.
We found out you're not going to die.
Yeah, that's that happened, good. Like, right at the end of the year. That's okay.
I reconnected with a couple of old friends that I wasn't sure I'd ever hear from again.
Oh, that's lovely. Yeah.
But, all in all, boy, was this year not good.
No, it was pretty bad. It was pretty bad.
I mean, there's some good to be found if you look. But, like, there was a lot of people who just... people who died, and it was not fun at all. Foreign people, and you know, that's going to probably continue into 2017 because
it is like celebrity culture became as big as it is now at around the time that, you know, the people that died this year were starting to get famous. Like, that all started like with these people. So we're going to get a lot more of this as time goes on.
It's the whole thing with like the baby boomers and whatnot. And that particular generation is all just hitting that age at the same time.
This is the point in time where like everyone who was there at the beginning of mass media becoming mass media, they're all really getting on in years now. So.
Yeah.
It's going to be rough for a while until it normalizes and becomes the new normal.
But, so you know, people aren't going to stop dying.
Nope. Not until a singularity, at least.
Wait, isn't that when robots become sentient and surpass us and kill us all?
Or when we can have people downloaded into a robot brain and just become robots. And then they don't die.
And then everything turns into soma.
I want to be a robot.
I suppose I would be able to live the joke from C-Lab 2021 or something like that. You can't handle the robo penis.
Moving on, if we may.
Yeah. So, you know, I think our podcast, you know, we've expanded a lot. We've added new shows. And I'm glad that I'm still here with all you guys.
Yeah.
And none of us are dead. So,
yeah.
That's none fantastic. Of us are dead, and we haven't had that tragic boy band breakup yet.
I'm glad to be here as well.
Yay.
Good to have you.
Because we know that tragic boy band breakup will happen at one point.
Yeah, inevitably, sure.
I hate you, Zero.
You know, the best friends play, the super best friends play, they had one person go on an extended break and one person leave.
Yeah, that sucks.
Right at the end of the year.
Like, really hard. I hate that. That sucks. Why did you
Liam left that? And Matt's on an extended break, and they're like my favorite Let's Play group. And now there's only like two people keeping the channel afloat.
Yeah, kudos to Pat and Wooly, though, for keeping the channel going instead of just like putting it entirely on break.
Those are the two that I actually liked because I watched their Dark Souls play. That was pretty good.
They're doing Dark Souls 1 now. Yeah. They broke the glass.
Duh. That was our thing. We did it first. I can actually say that this time.
They did Dark Souls 2, Dark Souls 3, Bloodborne, and Demon's Souls, and the last one they're doing is Dark Souls.
We did Dark Souls 2, then 3, then Dark Souls. They're just copying us.
But you didn't do Bloodborne, did you? Or Demon's Souls.
Or Demon's Souls, because none of us can afford a capture card for PS3. Shut up,
Slice. Imitation is the sincerest form of flattery.
Yeah, but they're famous.
Are you going to copyright their videos?
Yeah, but hey, Zero, now you know what I feel like when Ray left Achievement Hunter. So, yeah, screw you.
Yeah, I know. It sucks when a group that he follows starts to... like. It's not necessarily like there was bad blood between anybody. It's just like the stress in everybody. The stress was really starting to get to people.
Mm. And there's a lot of strain to keep a YouTube channel active.
Especially when you're, you know, Let's Players and the only thing you really offer is your personality and your gameplay, both of which can be criticized pretty harshly. Mm. So, yeah. 2016.
Audience, thank you for not being dicks.
Yeah, pretty fantastic audience.
Thank you for all of you being cool, except for those few people who seem to dislike our YouTube channel. And I guess they're people that just show up and like, oh, hey, this isn't my recommended videos. This quality is not 10 out of 10. I might as well dislike, and then they screw off.
Well, that actually helps with Google Analytics, so that's okay.
Yeah, that's using the dislike system what it's supposed to be used for, so I'm okay with that.
Yeah. Especially,
content, you don't dislike it.
Especially Ghost 13-24-35.
That's the first time I've heard it said that way, but okay.
We especially like to thank that particular user, I believe.
Yeah. He's the one that does a massive rundown of things that happen in the podcast and with time codes.
Yeah. And thanks to Ethan F., who always comments on videos that have no comment.
Also, Ghost 13245 has been with us since the very, very beginning.
Yeah.
Like, back in the Blogspot days.
Nice.
We are recognizing a longtime fan.
We've been going for over 3 years. Oh, God.
The walls are closing in.
You know what 2016 did also give?
What?
I saw this the other day, and I was like, why wasn't this? Look at this. There's an instrument that uses 2,000 marbles.
Oh, yeah. That's actually a really cool video. It's on... Whenever I listen to music, I just go to MyMix for YouTube, and that one goes on there, like, constantly. So
it's pretty good. So, yeah. Oh, boy.
What was Ghost's name before he was Ghost? Was he always
Ghost? I don't remember.
Wasn't it just Greek letters?
No, the Greek guy was a different guy, and he's still Greek guy. Bear with me. I'll pull up the Blogspot page.
I wish I knew the name of more fans, really.
There it is. It's still on there and everything, so, you know. We still have the archive of it.
Yeah. Like, you know, we know there's a amount of people that always watch our videos, and I wish that they would comment every time, but I understand that you can't always do that.
Was it Johnny Lobo?
Oh.
I think it might have been Johnny.
You don't always have something to say.
It was Johnny Lobo, Hufj08. Remember Hufj?
I remember Hufj.
He's actually been on the podcast before.
Yeah, a few times. Yeah, I think it might have been Johnny Lobo was Ghost. Maybe. I might be confusing people. If I am, I apologize.
You probably are, and you're probably a terrible person for confusing people. Look what you've done.
It's been 3 years.
That's not a suitable excuse. It's
kind of that means you should be better at this, not worse.
That hurts.
So, anything more? Any other fans to recognize, or...
Honestly, like, you know, that doesn't come to mind. I mean, Greek guy's been pretty inactive.
Yeah, I mean, people, you know, drop in and out when they feel like, which is, you know, it's kind of the point. We're entertainers. If you're not being entertained, you can just do as you like and not watch the videos. It's perfectly fine. Likewise, if you want to see what we've been doing and just get back into it, yay. Welcome back. Appreciate it.
I'm just glad people watch.
Yeah. And listen.
And even if they don't, I like making it, so.
I'd rather have 8 views on a video than 2. You know what I mean? Hey, the Zero Interest series is doing well.
Yeah.
Right. I actually watched that recently. I marathoned all the episodes. It's very good. I like it.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Who do you like better? Zero or me?
Ruby.
Oh. I guess that makes sense. She is adorable.
The best cast member. I meant the show as a whole.
Yeah.
There's just as much you guys as there is Ruby.
Okay, so I guess we'll move on to 2017, and also to recommendations of things that happened in 2016 and previous. So, recommendations?
I have one myself. This is another one from Psyluck, whose story Boy with the Scar I recommended a while back. It's still going strong, and I've sort of signed on as a beta reader for that particular story now, so I'm having a lot of fun with the One Piece fandom.
Okay. So that was Boy with the Scar?
Yeah.
The Scar or A Scar?
A.
A Scar.
Yeah. But I'm recommending a different story of his this time around. It's called For Better or For Worse. It's a Peggy Sue story. It's only 7 chapters thus far. But it's made enough good changes to plot that I feel comfortable recommending it. Basically, a 30-some-odd-year-old Luffy returns to the past in his into his 6-year-old body using a something or other that the Pirate King had. And he's...
Oh, that's interesting. You're using the One Piece.
Probably. I mean, probably. Sounds like it.
Like, if you're using something the Pirate King had, then you're using the One Piece, basically.
Probably.
I mean, he did have other things.
He had everything.
Well, that is in the opening narration, so I guess that's true.
Okay. Yeah, the One Piece is literally everything a pirate could ever want.
But anyway, return to a 6-year-old body, and...
But I thought a pirate and wanted basically... adventure.
And basically from there, he's determined to protect everything that he lost before. Basic time travel, wanting to get back what you lost sort of thing. But there's a significant twist near the start of this one. One of the very first things Luffy does, besides letting his grandfather in on the secret at the start, is... traveling to the South Blue and saving Law and Corazon and bringing them home with him, along with Beppo. So there's basically another member to the ASL trio. And they have a father figure.
And a bear.
And a bear, yes. Another friend of theirs, but yeah.
But he's a bear.
And he's sorry for it.
You don't have to be sorry for being a bear. That's...
But he does. He does, clearly, because he says he's sorry every time someone points it out. That's a canon quirk of his that Oda gave him for some reason or another. Anyway, that's...
There's racial segregation or something. It's really sad, actually.
That's basically what it is so far. Luffy rebuilding relationships with the ones that he cared about before. Shanks, his brothers, his grandfather to an extent. And he's regrowing... He's training again for all of his, to get all of his muscles back because he didn't retain anything except his haki as he went back in time. So, it's not updating particularly fast, but quality over quantity, and it's definitely not dead. So that's my recommendation for this week.
I've got a couple of things in my alerts list that I could recommend, but I think I'm going to recommend something that I've barely started reading. It's called Hypnotherapy. And it's a Ruby fic by Zelkova48. The plot is Jean is shit, and he has no confidence. Yes.
Okay.
So, Pyrrha and Ruby decide we need to help Jean out. Maybe get him some counseling or something. And Ruby is like, yeah, but he probably say no, and then looks at the comic book that she's reading that has one of those terrible advertisements for a 3D hypno ring. So she decides, hey, why don't we try hypnotizing him? It'll totally work because it works in the comics.
100% ethical.
Yeah. So they do this, and it works, kind of. They hypnotize him and say, hey, you need to be more confident and sure of yourself and be super awesome and do everything the best you can and you'll be awesome.
That sounds very flawed. Oh my gosh. Don't say that.
They don't realize that it works because he was so tired that he actually fell asleep during the hypnosis. But the next morning, he comes down to breakfast, and he is no longer Jean Arc. He has become Juan Arc. Lover of ladies. And oh, yes. Valiant warrior.
Link it now.
Oh, I need to read this.
I think I finished the first... Is it good if I finish the first season?
I don't know, because I've only read two chapters, and that was the introduction of Juan Arc. So, I don't know.
If I see anything slightly spoilery, I'll stop reading. Juan Arc.
It's surprisingly easy to read it in, like, Miles Luna's voice, who's the voice Miles actor, but if he was doing a Spanish accent.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
All right. You've got me interested.
I'll go ahead and pass it on to my fellows of the Crossbrain. I'm not into Ruby, but they are.
Oh, fair enough. Yeah, so this is the first hypnosis. Based on the chapter titles, there is one later on where he becomes Johann Arc and possibly a tiger somehow. I'm not entirely sure on that last one, but yeah.
Where does he become? I am Jean Arc. Just how many puns can you make off his name of other names? Just.
When does he call himself Noah?
Okay.
Noah Arc.
Yeah, so that's my recommendation this week. Like I say, I could have recommended other things, but this one seemed...
I was expecting like it was going to go dark or something, but no. Juanok. That okay.
Yeah, so that's my recommendation.
Yeah. Besides, it's smart to only... I recommend one thing per week, lest you run out.
So it is. Slicer, do you have anything?
I believe I recommended this one before, but it updated just a few days ago. Frigis Armum. Yep. That is the one where John gets Jack Frost powers from the Last Guardian. Or not Last Guardian. Rise of the Guardians. Mm. It's good. It's quite good. It takes a while to actually get to Beacon. He kind of hangs around Junior's club. Catches the eye of Neo, unfortunately. She is... Okay, you know the cat girl expression? The dots and then the three? That basically sums up her entire personality.
Yep.
Only with more blood. So, that's not a good thing, but it's very entertaining.
Yes, it is. And Yang's a bitch.
Yeah. She gets better, at least.
But, does she?
Yes, she does, yeah. The club scene in the beginning is pointed out for all of its flaws, and it gets a little tiresome that he keeps poking at it, but eh.
Have you read the most recent chapter?
I'm rereading it, so I'm on 6 of 11. I believe 11 was the latest chapter.
Okay. gonna. Okay. Yep. Yep. So.
As for me.
Didn't you recommend something? Oh, we started Impatient, didn't we? Yeah. Sorry.
I recently marathoned through 190 chapters of a Chinese novel called Release That Witch. And the premise is there's this guy and he's a mechanical engineer and he dies dies later on into his life from overworking. And he wakes up and he's, it's in another world, but he's become the worst prince of the royal family and he's in a border town that's full of shacks and he's about to give an order to execute a witch. And basically it turns into, I know all this stuff about mechanical engineering. I know all this stuff from my many years of, studying this stuff that I can start an industrial revolution in this town, using the witches to help me get through any, sort of bottlenecks. Like there's a witch that, has an ability over fire and temperature that she can use to, help him create the first steam engine, basically. And it's about kind of going forward like that. And it's really interesting how he gets all these witches that have like one ability that he can help them utilize and try to start an industrial revolution in a kingdom where he has to fight for the succession, basically. But his character is basically kind of somewhat overlooked because he's literally has the worst reputation possible starting off.
As like and, a murderer, a rapist, why is his reputation so like, bad?
Because he's incompetent, greedy, and lazy, and just an awful person.
Stuff. Okay.
Yeah. And so he's literally on like the edge of the country and border town where there's just shacks and mud streets. And he's like, first thing he's going to do is like, okay, in 3 months, there'll be like a winter where all these monsters are going to attack us. We're going to stay here, though. We're not going to relocate because when we relocate, everybody starts to die and I won't be able to fully industrialize the town the way I want to. So I'm going to have to work on building walls. Well, this is the formula for cement. So we have cement, we can build actual walls fast enough to defend and stuff like that. And it's really interesting the way things unfold. And there's nothing he really does that can't be accomplished with his level of knowledge. It's not like he's a super genius that invents an AK-47 right off the bat. But it's really, really interesting read. I recommend it. Okay. I'll put a link for it here, the novel updates link. So check it out.
All right. All right. So I guess that's it for this episode of the podcast and for this year. So yay.
Hey, you know what? 2017 probably not be anywhere near as good as 2016.
You say that. It is uncomfortably true.
There's one thing coming up in 2017 that I've been looking forward to for a few years now. I looked it up a while back when I was still in high school, and this year is going to mark the first time in my life that I'm going to be able to witness a total solar eclipse from where I am.
Nice! Cool. And hey, the new Nintendo console comes out next year, so look forward to that.
Won't be getting it for 2 years, until it goes cheap.
That's reasonable. I don't think it would be more than $300.
That's not too bad, actually.
Yeah, Nintendo is usually the cheap console.
Alright, so with that being said, I think that's it for this week's podcast. This end Yay. Of the year is here.
Yay!
We will see you guys in 2017.
Yeah, so I would like to thank everybody for listening to the FanFlux Podcast episode 160. If you'd like to get in contact with us, you can do so through the YouTube channel, through comments. Please donate on Patreon if you feel so inclined. Once again, I'd like to thank everybody for listening to the FanFlux Podcast episode 160, and Happy New Year. ladies and gentlemen.
Happy New Year! Follow through on your resolution. Seriously, follow through.
What little good you can.
Don't just say I'm going to work out and get skinnier and then just fall out of it. You can do it.
It's uncanny that you managed to guess my resolution so quickly, but I have been talking about it for the past few months. So.
That's the resolution everyone has.
Well, I got weighed at the hospital and I'm 14 stone 6, so that's... Yeah, I need to...
I don't know what that means, but let's go.
Goodbye!
Why would you marry yourself in, or measure yourself in rocks, you weird Brit?
14 times 14 equals 190. Holy shit, I'm 202 pounds.
Oh, really?
Okay.
That's not that heavy at all.
It's like 25 more than me, roughly.
No, I'm fat. So I should probably stop recording at some point, right?
I suppose.
Yeah.
Patient already hopped out.
Yeah.
So.
I don't know. Audience, you want to hang out?
Stop it. This isn't a stream. There's nobody here.
I got to call my teacher, so I'll see you guys later.
Okay. Bye then.
Bye.